All right. As we shift a little bit away from the idea of working in Newton's second law and those sorts of problems, one of the things that's really interesting is Newton came up with this really interesting idea called momentum. And I want to talk a little bit about where that idea comes from, why it's such an important idea. And the place we really want to start with is with Newton's second law, expressed in its less mathematically useful form, but probably the one that encapsulates what's going on, which is the idea that take all of our forces, we add them up, we get a net force, that net force causes an acceleration. Now, it turns out Newton actually never wrote this down. If you actually go to the Principia and you sit down and you work through Newton, Newton never actually writes the second law in this form. He has a second law of motion. It's very, you know, you can see where this comes from the second law of motion, but he doesn't actually write this expression down. This is written down a little later on. What Newton does is, Newton hates acceleration as much as you guys do. What you have to remember is in Newton's time, 1670, 1680, fastest thing probably Newton's familiar with is a horse, okay? Horses don't come with built-in speedometers, and so the idea of the change in a rate, velocity is the rate of the position, acceleration being the rate of the velocity, the change in a rate is a difficult idea, difficult concept, certainly not beyond what Newton can do, but he doesn't like dealing with the change of a rate symbolically in this way. So what he writes down is something a little different, and I want to kind of walk you through that just a bit. Now, what we can do is we can use our definition of acceleration to rewrite this equation. We can say that F net is equal to M, and we know that the acceleration is the change in velocity with respect to time. Okay. Now, for those of you who have had a little bit of calculus, one of the things that you know you can do is if you have an expression that's like this and you know that that mass is constant, you can take the mass in and out of the change in sign. Those of you who don't have the calculus and haven't seen that, you're just going to have to take it on faith that that's a legal move. But I can rewrite this as the change in M times V times the change in time. Now, that turns out to be a really useful thing to be able to do. Okay, and this is actually where Newton gets his definition of momentum. What Newton then does is Newton actually defines this quantity. We call it P now. It is the momentum. It's defined as M times V. Okay, that's actually how he defines momentum. Now, I'll come back to this in just a second, so just put this on the back burner for a second, but I want to finish up the mathematical thought in the line before. So now what we can say is that F net is equal to the change in momentum over the change in time, and this is actually much closer to what Newton wrote as his second law of motion. Now, we want to talk just for a few moments about what momentum actually is. Most folks have no problem getting the idea correct that momentum is tied to an object's velocity. Anything that is moving has momentum, and what you'll notice is momentum is a vector quantity. Not only does it have a magnitude, it has a direction. You have a direction in which your momentum is pointed. But what a lot of folks kind of forget is that in their head they have this linear relationship between the momentum and the velocity, and they forget that mass. So let me give you a couple of examples to sort of help you sort of sort that out in your brain. An example of an object that would have a tremendous amount of momentum without having very much velocity would be a slow-moving train. Here in Barnesville, we've got a train, runs through the middle of town, runs about 5 miles an hour, blocks about half the streets for students trying to get to the college. Let's say I have a train that's only moving about 5 miles an hour. Let's say it's the engine. And let's say I can, you know, put one of those cars that have, you know, railroad wheels going the other direction. It's a normal-sized car going the other direction. And so, in a sense, you can think I have my big locomotive and my little car. My little car has a great big velocity, but has a little mass. My train has a big mass and a little tiny velocity. Okay? Well, if those two guys run into each other, we know who's going to win that collision, right? Train's going to win that every time. Not only because it's built stronger, but also because that train has more momentum. It has so much more mass that the amount of velocity that the car might be able to produce is not going to equal that out. Okay, so this would be an example of a system that has a lot of mass and a little bit of velocity, but it creates an enormously large amount of momentum. Another example, kind of the opposite sense of that, that's a kind of a little grisly or a little gruesome sometimes to think about it, bullets. Bullets turn out to have a negligible amount of momentum. Bullets can have a very, very large velocity, But a bullet has a very small mass. If I recall just some of the research I've done, a 45 automatic bullet has a mass of about 14.5 grams. Okay, that's 14.5 grams, that's 0.0145 kilograms. Okay, if you look at that Colt 45 automatic, it's about 263 meters per second for that object, that bullet's velocity. When you multiply those two things together, you don't get a very big number. Bullets have a very small momentum. So there's that misconception that you get in a lot of movies. You know the movie I'm talking about, right? The movie with the actor from the Central European School of Bad Acting. And you know there's some crisis and the heroine needs some saving. And so the actor, hero, he gets his large caliber firearm. And the bad guy comes running at him, and he takes up his large caliber firearm, and he shoots the bad guy, and the bad guy is hit by the bullet, and he goes flying backwards, and the day is saved. And then the actor, he goes on to become the governor of the great state of California, right? You know the movie, right? Well, that's absolute fiction, total Hollywood. The bullet doesn't have enough momentum to actually knock the guy backwards, okay? So this would be an example of something with a lot of velocity, but because it has such a small mass, it doesn't have very much. So, now, if we go back and we look at this, we can then sit down and wrap this up. And by the way, if you need to pause the video to stop laughing, you can do that. So, if we look at this, we can then rearrange this equation fairly straightforwardly. We can multiply both sides by delta t. We can get the change in momentum is equal to F net delta t. This quantity here is usually called the impulse, and given most of the time, the symbol J. In doing that, we can then write what's called the impulse momentum relationship. And it says that the change in momentum is equal to the impulse. And this is actually how Newton wrote his second law of motion. Now, this expression is really, really interesting. We're going to talk a little bit about a couple of pieces of this very quickly. First off, though, to understand what's going on here, the reason Newton uses terms like momentum and impulse is because he's dealing with an old Aristotelian idea called impetus. Aristotle had this idea that objects move because they have this stuff called impetus, and it's like gas in a gas tank. As long as you have impetus, you keep moving, but to move, you have to use up your impetus. When you run out of impetus, you stop moving. Well, Newton says, look, that's totally incorrect. What objects have is they have momentum. When you apply an impulse, you change the momentum. If there's no net force, the impulse or the momentum never changes because the impulse is zero, and that's Newton's first law of motion. But if I have an impulse, a net force applied over a certain amount of time, I then change the momentum, object speeds up, slows down, changes direction, which is what we talked about in Newton's second law. Okay. Now, one really great way to think about the impulse is if I am able to plot a graph of net force as a function of time. In a collision, let's say, you have, a baseball colliding with a baseball bat. When we look at the force on the baseball, that force curve might look something like that. It turns out is if you add up the area under this curve, that is, in fact, your impulse. Now, normally, in this expression, since we don't have a calculus that allows us to calculate the area of that curve, what we're thinking of is actually more of an average net force, where we're calculating the equivalent area of a rectangle to that. But it's the same basic idea. You're looking at the area under the force versus time curve. And when you do an accident analysis, an accident reconstruction, let's say Vince and Larry the dummies and the car commercials that you always hear about, or you know the cool commercials where they show how much you know damage gets done to the dummy inside the seat or whatever. These are the kinds of calculations they're doing to determine whether that dummy's going to break an arm or shatter their skull or whatever happens in a head-on or side-on collision. So these are the types of calculations that are done there. So this sets up the idea of momentum for you, kind of gives you sort of a where this comes from and where you're going with it. Make sure you read the chapter on this because what we're going to do is we're going to work from this to try to get a better understanding of how to set up collision-style problems. Keep working on it.